Okay, everybody, welcome back into Strange Ways. Lucky number 13 for the episode. And your boy Scott will introduce what we're doing.
All right, guys, we're going back to semi-roots. Going back to my favorite part of the band. We just left Rob's favorite part of the band. Now we're entering my favorite part. And probably, now I'll have to reflect a little bit on the, I'm pretty sure this was the second thing I ever owned by them, the Destroyer album. Rock and Roll Over Destroyer, Hotter Than Hell, Dressed to Kill. I think that's the way it went for me. But anyway, we're going to rock on some Destroyer now. We might make some of you guys happy out there today. And then again, we might not. Just don't know how this is going to go. This one right here, man, believe it or not, this one wasn't hard for me, man. I don't know about you. Hell, I think Crazy Nights was harder for me than this, truly. But we're going to rock on some Destroyer, and we're going to rank our songs from the least favorite to favorite in our personal opinion on this album. And give us what you think we need to get, man. What do you guys like? What do y'all think's the worst? What do you think's the best? What do you think should have been trash? Whatever. We don't care. Rob, you can roll it first this time. I think I went first last time, so I believe you're up to
the surprising thing here on, and I guess I really never paid attention. There's only 9 tracks on here if you don't count Rock and Roll Party.
Nine tracks.
I won't be counting, but I will say this. How cool would that have been to be playing loud behind the guy introducing you wanted the best, you got the best all these years while that playing in the background? That would have been cool.
If I'm not mistaken, they did play that in the background on their first reunion tour at Detroit. The first show they done. Yes. That was in the background or whatever, loud or whatever before they came out. And then the guy, you know, done his thing and they came out, man. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that was the only time.
And I didn't know that existed when I was a kid. I had the Destroyer album and listened to it front and back nonstop. And then somehow I snagged a used 8-track. And we had one of those big, you know, living room stereo coffins.
Yeah,
it looks like
the big 4 stereos.
And it had the phonograph and it had AM, FM and an 8-track. So I'm listening to this 8-track sitting in the living room, and all of a sudden this fucking cheering starts, and there's this haunting sound of Great Expectations, and all of a sudden Paul starts echoing, and I'm like, what in the hell is this? So I didn't even know that existed for a couple of years as a kid of listening to Destroyer. And in fact, it's not even listed. I got 2 CDs. Somehow I ended up with 2 of them. And that's not listed as a track on either of them.
No,
I don't know
if
it's hidden. I don't know if it's hidden and comes up later after a pause. I've never really listened to it all the way through. But
yeah, it blew my mind. Sit there and just tranced on the whole thing until it went off, dude.
Yeah.
And you know, for years, I did not realize that was off of a Live 1. I never realized that.
How could that be off a Live 1 if it's got Great Expectations?
Well, it's the Paul's talking.
Oh, Paul's stage route?
Yeah, well, I'm rocking all night. On a live. Okay, well,
you just broke that news to me because I had no idea until you just said it.
But it was decades, bro, before it clicked. I didn't put it. I guess because of the expectation music, I didn't really. Next time you listen to Live One, we're gonna have ourselves a rock and roll party tonight. You know, that's where they took it.
So they cut off him saying tonight, and that's why it sounds so different.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. All right. Go ahead.
Oh no! You got it. You go ahead. You're in command on this one.
So starting at number nine, and I will full disclosure right now say I don't hate anything on this album. This whole album is either spectacular or very good. Every single track for me. So this is easy for me in a sense that I know what my favorites are because I've went back and used them tracks in my listening time for 40 years. But number nine is going to be Beth, just because, you know me, ballad, sappy, good song. Gave me goosebumps on the reunion with that piano hit for the first time in my life, experiencing that song live. But at the end of the day, it's still a ballad, and it's not a power ballad.
Yeah.
You swishing a fly or are you swishing me away?
I know how you feel about ballads now. So, yeah, that's as far as it gets, man. And let me follow up what Rob said. There's nothing on here that I hate. There's nothing on this album that I hate. It's just there's some songs on here that I like. And there's songs on here that I love. That's the way it goes. And they just had to fall somewhere. And that's just basically what I'm doing with this album. This is such a sentimental album for me, too. And just looking at them on this album, man, it's just insane. The destruction in the background. And, you know, it's just what a child's mind can create. Just by looking the masterpiece album covers, that was their second three studio albums, Destroyer, Rock and Roll Over, and Love Gun. The imagination, which that's the time I came in, you know. So number nine for me, it's weird not saying 10, I think it's always been this, Great Expectations. And a song when I was a kid that it didn't grab me. I didn't understand it because I was just listening to Gene sing God of Thunder and now he's singing Great Expectations. It kind of twisted my mind a little bit, but I didn't hate it because I love the part where Gene is, his voice is fucking awesome in this song. He's not got the demon voice in this song. He's got more of the Beatlesque voice, but not the solo album extent. It's a little bit more, okay? And I love Gene's voice like that. I love the Dr. Love voice. And that I really do. I think I like it better than the demon voice, bro, in the songs that he sings like that. Dude, I shit you not, because he does got a better voice than what he gets credit for. Gene does on his masterpieces, but when they're jamming and Peter's just got his little, you know, his little thing going on there, you know, and Gene's singing, you know, that to me, I love that part of the song. The part that kills it for me is where they just continuously, at the end, we've got great expectations. You know, it don't kill it for me, but that's what makes it the lowest for me. Let me put it that way. I like the song. I always have, but it kind of threw me for a loop when I was a kid, a little bit, you know, because I'm like, is that Gene? So.
Okay. Just to piggyback a little bit. Go ahead.
do like it when they put it in the symphony concert. I think they've done a absolutely just wicked job with it. See, when they put stuff in like that that they don't play, man, I love it. Even though MTV Unplugged was acoustic, the shit they played made it worth it to me. I love, you know, that's me. Yeah.
Okay, to piggyback off your album cover thing and the imagination of a child, that just was so true when you were saying that, because paging through Alive One's booklet, some of the most evil, sadistic pictures for a child under 10 years old to see. I remember the one of Gene kind of leaning back, and he's got the big beaded cob piece. And it's got such color coordination on it that it reminded me of like beetles crawling up in my, it was just weird where my mind went, and that evil look on his face. Even Ace, his pose live in there with the pink lights on his face, and he had this weird look. They were so evil to me that I couldn't help but be drawn to them. And this album cover, and listening to things like God of Thunder, and even the intro to Detroit City with the car crash and everything. And I'm staring at this cover and seeing them standing on ruins. I literally believe that this band could destroy the world if they wanted to. I mean, it was almost like, I equated them to some kind of supernatural power long before the comic book correlation was made. I was scared to death of this band. I loved every minute.
And to touch on that, I was the same way, because I thought they stayed that way. I thought they looked that way. They wore that all the time. They lived together all the time. They were always together. Sex, drugs, rock and roll all the time. I don't know about the drugs at that point in time, you know, but just rocking all, just party, just all the time. I thought what I wouldn't do when I grow up is to be them, that's what I want to be right there.
So my number nine, speaking of evil, will piss off a lot of people. Go ahead.
I was going to tell you while you was talking about the Alive, I've still got that in the Alive. I've still got the book in the plastic and everything. So awesome, dude. Don't ever get rid of that till you're 90. Then it'll be worse.
So my number eight, again, piggybacking off the evil vibe, probably upset some people, is God of Thunder. Yes, it is the very personification of what the demon character was. Yes, it's a great song. It scared the hell out of me with the kids screaming and talking. Even the echo at the end with that chee-chee, and it just, the whole song scared the hell out of me. But musically, as an adult, I don't go play this song. It's more of a novelty song. Maybe something you pull out on Halloween night or something. Halloween, for me. I mean, it's a good song. It really is. And oddly enough, I enjoyed Paul Stanley's original demo of this song.
I did too until they go,
but to hear Paul singing,
and then I was like, what the
yes, but I loved Paul's badass voice, I loved the pace of it.
But
the song itself, God of Thunder, is a great song. Don't get me wrong, anybody. It's just, like I said before many times, when I got an album full of songs that I like, every single one of them, I got to pull back and say, okay, which ones do I listen to the most on purpose? And God of Thunder, I wouldn't grab, whether it's overplay, whether it's just not, like I said, kind of a novelty song for me, like pulling out Monster Mash in the middle of July. I don't know. It just, that's where it falls for me.
Yeah, man. And I can see that, because when I was just first got this album and I first heard this song, Now, I can't remember if I heard this song because, see, my cousins, they, you know, one of my cousins, two of my cousins, they had this stuff too, man. A lot of them before I did. So I may have been over at their house and heard it too. But when I got my Destroyer album, I, God of Thunder was not my song. I mean, even though it was creepy and it was, but it just, I thought, what are they, you know, I just got to listening to Detroit Rock City and King of Nighttime World. What are they doing here? You know, what's happening, man? They've really got down. And then the creepy back tones and all the echoes. So it wasn't really, this is something that hit me not long after, man, that I just personified. There's two songs as a child that I personified Gene Simmons with to the bone. And I know everybody's got their own songs that do that with these characters here. And it's Dr. Love and God of Thunder. To me, those two songs are Gene Simmons to the bone. Those two songs, just that is Gene. Gene can get no more Gene than that. So that's the image that I've had forever. But anyway, my number eight is a song that I like. There you go. You know what I mean? I like it.
But number eight?
Eight but nine over here, right?
Yeah, there was only nine. So your number nine was what again?
Great Expectations. Yours was Bad.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then you had God of Thunder. And yes, then okay. Mine is Gene, but it's a Sweet Pain. And that, look, this is one of those songs where I love it when he starts off, you love it around me. I mean, they're jamming, man. You know, it's the chorus that does it for me on this song. And the hey, you love to drive me insane. I mean, they repeat it just a little bit too much for me. But the verse, the intro, all that, this song, I can listen to it anytime. I mean, I really don't have a problem with it. Like I said, just like Rob said, there's nothing on here that I won't listen to and that I don't like. And this is just where that would fail in number eight.
Okay. And that is my number seven. I do like the song. And like you said, what that love gives time. I mean, it's just a badass verse to start this thing out. I don't mind the chorus, but I was even puzzled as a kid, is like, why are there little kids singing halfway through this song on the chorus? Yeah. Doesn't it sound like there's children singing along Sweet Pain?
You know, that's women.
Is it?
That's chicks. And if you'll think about it, on Tomorrow and Tonight, it must be the same chicks that are singing on that, because they sound like the Chipmunks to me. I always thought it was a damn Chipmunks. I'm like, how the hell did they get Alvin and Theodore and whatever his name is in here? Simon. Yeah. What's happening here? Because they really do sound like little girls, 5-year-old girls or something, high pitched coming out. So, yeah.
But it's a good song. It really is. It's a toe tapper. I don't understand the hate for it that it seems to get in Kiss circles, but you know, it's definitely not a standout on this album by any means.
No, and I don't understand the hate. Like you said, I mean, damn, dude, it's not bad. I mean, considering, you know, some of the stuff. Number seven, and I know this in here is probably going to get some recoil. But I like the song and always have, dude. It's a staple in every damn show. Every damn show. When, in all honesty, this is one that I think that they could swap out and put something else in. It's Shouted Out Loud at number seven. And don't get me wrong. This song is great. I love what it's about. I love the jam to it. Paul and Gene trading off, dude. It's It's a damn good. I always, as a kid, it was one of my favorites, man. I think if the overplay is Watts, because Rock and Roll All Night is not going to be my number one anymore.
No.
Just like Shout It Out Loud, I've heard it every time, man. You know, every show. And I'll rock out to it, you know, but some things we talked about this before. The first album and the Destroyer album, they praise more than anything they've ever done. And look, I'm not saying you know, that's a bad thing at all. But you've got so much good stuff the fans would want to hear. You don't have to play every, you know, you got to play some things off here. You know that. Some things you really don't have to. Now, try to tell Paul that, but anyway, that's my number seven.
They got a lot of songs like that. Like I said, I would love for us to do an episode of Create Your Ideal Realistic Set List. But realistic's a stipulation here, because you can't just say, well, I would play Hard Times. I mean, come on, you know that's never going to happen. But what I would like to do is create your own preference for a realistic set list without using the first album and Destroyer.
Oh.
Just because if you think about what Kiss has done for 50 years, you take those two albums out of the rotation and they play a half hour.
That's the majority.
And when you got 23 fucking studio albums, that's not good that you lived for 50 years on two albums live.
And no offense to all the albums they've made after their successful 70s run, but to me, that's like shitting on Hotter Than Hell, Dressed to Kill with the exception of Rock and Roll All Night, and fucking Rock and Roll Over, and Love Gun.
Mm-hmm.
Dude. So there you go. I spit out a little hate quarrel there, a little rant. There you go. So.
Okay, so what, my number seven?
Yeah, I was shouted out loud. It'll be your number six, right?
Yeah, I started. So I had Beth, God of Thunder,
and Sweet Pain.
And Sweet Pain.
Yeah.
And yeah. Okay. So my number six is Great Expectations. I like this song a lot more than most that I have heard or spoken with or known. But being as a mid-tempo song and lacking any kind of rock out ability to it, it falls a little bit on here. But I love what Scott does not like. I love the choir at the end repeating that, and that's why I loved it so much on the symphony when they brought the children's choir out. I just get a kick out of that big chorus with a choir type. I'm a big production guy. A lot of people, it's too fucking overproduced. Well, I guess if I want to hear a band stripped down, I'll just go listen to them at a fucking nightclub or in their garage practicing. When I listen to an album, I want a production. That's why they're paying all that money for fucking studio time and producers and engineers and shit. I mean, why not get the fullest sound you can? So I've always been a fan of that. What I'd hate is the fucking demo version of this where it's you can Peter and Ace and then none of that is as corny as you wanted the best off of Psycho Circus. But this version on this album, and especially like Scott said, the symphony version,
great stuff. Hell, I like that where he mentions the.
You do?
Yeah. He doesn't mention Ace on here, man.
No, I'm saying on the demo.
It was ridiculous.
Yeah. It was just a cheese fest.
Okay. I got you. I'm with you. And I just wondered about that too, you know. I never thought much about it, but we left Ace off here. Okay. My next one is 987. Number six is my favorite. Here we go. Not your favorite, but you done touched on this. my favorite ballad they've ever done. And don't ask
really?
Me, don't, yes, yes, yes. Don't ask me why. I love Peter's voice. I've always loved Peter too, man. And I love this song. I've always loved this song. I don't know what it is. If anybody else would have sung it, I probably wouldn't wipe my ass with it. But there's something about Peter and this song. This, when I think of Peter Criss, this is what I think of. Just like Gene with Dr. Love and God of Thunder. Yeah, I love Peter's heavy stuff more now as I've gotten older. But growing up, when I thought of Peter Criss, Beth is the first thing I think of. That's the song as a child that just infused me with him, man. And it's a brilliant song. I know it wasn't a brilliant song when he first brought it in, but when Bob Ezrin got done with it, dude, they can say what they want to about him. It was a masterpiece. I just didn't think it was going to be the song to save their asses before they got Rock and Roll Over out. You know, I would have never dreamed that, because you don't know that stuff back then. I didn't know for a long time that was what happened. I did not know that. This is my favorite ballad that Kiss has ever done, right here. And I love a lot of the ballads, but I do not like a lot of them too. So this is it. Damn it. I'm losing my mind, bro. I must be having Alzheimer's or some shit, man. Nostalgia. There we go.
Yeah.
But this song I never skip, you know. This is one of them, man. Even though with the violins and Peter's voice, Peter's voice is insane. And I just love it. I love about everything Peter does, to be honest with you. I think he's the only one in the band that, with the exception of his solo album, that I don't like every song that he's done with the band, bro.
Okay. Well, I can definitely understand the appeal audibly of Peter's voice on this song, as was never so evident as when Eric Carr did it on Smashes, Thrashes, and Hit.
Oh,
Hits. Now, of course, my wife loves that one more because it's got a better voice. Technically, you know, sonically a better voice. But my brother says, just like I do, you can't take that rasp out of, and the imperfection out of that song. That's what makes that song. And that's why.
Yeah,
that whole smoky voice of Peter's, it just fits. It is a great ballad. The symphony production behind it is great. However, it is, for me, it is a skippable track 10 out of 10 times. Now, I would not skip it if I could have a studio sound produced version of the acoustic one off of Kiss Meets the Phantom.
Okay.
I think that would be fantastic.
I like that
as
one
much
too.
As much as I love symphony sound, I think with his voice that would work so much better with the acoustic and the 12 string. But yeah, it's a great song. It's just skippable for me because that's too ballady for me. You know, I'm comfortable enough in my manhood to say it is a beautiful song. It's just not my preference to listen to.
A little too sappy for you.
Yeah. Anyway, so that was your number.
That was my six. Number 9, 8. So that's number 6, man. Yeah.
Okay. So my number 5 will be Do You Love Me? Great, unique song. I mean, this is what makes this album so goddamn hard for me, because, like I said, the songs I don't love, I like a lot, like you said. And Do You Love Me is, I love how they do it live.
Yes.
I the ending on this drives me goddamn nuts on the studio.
I love
that. Really?
That's Paul and his, that voice he's had back in. I love, yeah. I just got to know. Yeah, man. I do. I'm a fan of that.
But I absolutely love the breakdown in the middle where it goes from, you know, that rough voice to your backstage pass. And yes. I mean, that melody just, that is such a great change up melody for that song. And then all of a sudden, but he goes right back in it. Great song.
That's power. Yeah, man.
Yeah.
I agree, brother. I'm with you on that one, dude. Number five. Okay. Now, let's go ahead and make this case before I go any further, because Beth was my number six. From Beth up, I love. I like Expectation, Sweet Pain, and Shout It Out Loud. I like those songs a lot. I listen to them anytime. I'm already in the love category with Beth. And my next one is the other song. When I looked at the album cover, and this song emulated it more than any song on here. Flaming Youth, brother. We're going to set the world on fire, man. Dude, that beat. My parents think I'm crazy. I mean, dude, it's hard to put these songs from here up, man. I just realistically, I think the only thing that hurts this one for me is the middle breakdown that goes a little bit too long, but I don't have a problem with it because I've loved it my whole life. There you go. Yep.
Okay. So now we're in my love territory. And number four coming in is King of the Nighttime World. Severely overlooked track until the late, late years when they started giving it some love. This is Paul at his biggest badass persona. He wasn't always that star-crossed lover, star-child crap, right? That didn't start till the late 70s, early 80s dynasty-ish type stuff. He was a tough SOB with his voice. And this song is a personification of it. Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah,
everybody on there but Gene has an awesome costume. I don't like that one of Gene's.
Really? We're going to do man.
Yeah, we are. That's why I'm not going to say anymore. But yeah, King of the Nighttime World. Great chorus. I love that at the end. I'm the king. The king. I mean, it's just a power, power song. Yeah. Killer drum beat all the way through.
And what is funny about this is Peter says this, they claim this is their white album. And he, in my opinion, Peter done his best drumming on Hotter Than Hell and Dressed to Kill. Peter says he done his best drumming on this album. His hardest drumming, he said Ezra had him so fucking mad, dude, he wanted to strangle his fucking brains out. He said, but if our common ground's going to be cocaine, he said, I'm going to try to do as much. He said Ezra had mounds of cocaine on the dadgum board back there. And Gene thought it, Gene and Paul was like, thought it was sweet and low. Get the fuck out of here, Gene. He said he was going to try to stay on Ezrin's level doing that. He said, but there was no way in hell. He said Ezrin had a nose like a fucking aardvark. He said there wasn't no way in hell he butt with that.
And Ezrin's got a history of bringing the talent out of people because he fucking, I remember Bruce Kulick after Revenge was recorded saying he damn near had to break his fingers to play that shit Ezrin wanted him to do for them solos.
Yes, they did not. And he said Ace even worse. He did not like, he said, but after everything was done and the smoke clear, they sing the Method to the Madness. They understood and it made them disciplined. All right. And I love him for it too. But, all right. Number four. What am I thinking about? I'm losing it, bro. God dang. Number four for me is God of Thunder, the demon personification. Not my favorite at first listen. Scary, creepy, nightmarish, like you said, a different tempo from what they just done. And but as times went on, this is Gene to the bone. This is what started really the demonic character, even though you could say, you know, Delaney and his character started years before, but song, just song clicking with a, you know, just overall larger than life being, this would have
been. Well, that's it. The early years, he was definitely, if you watch some of the live stuff, he was scarier. Oh. But there wasn't a song to complement that scariness until God of Thunder.
Did you see when he was, before they played 100,000 Years, I think it was a live one, it's a clip where Gene's getting ready to spit the blood and he's doing that like a snake.
Yeah.
And he's doing that. Oh, dude. Yeah, that's Gene, bro. That was Gene, man. Yeah. I love it. Love it all. But God of Thunder, man. The Halloween song, okay. Dude, it sounds like Halloween. It's probably the creepiest song they've ever done as far as being just creepy. That's it for me, number four, and I love it to this day, and I never get tired of this one. I love this version way better than the live version, and that's another topic we're going to get into, because I'm not going to spill the beans on that one, is our live preferences over the studio preferences. That's going to be a damn good one now.
Okay, my number three, and this is where it's really hard. My number four?
You started, didn't you, or me?
I started with Beth.
Okay.
And then, all right. And yours, okay. Number nine was Great Expectations.
If you started then, yeah, it's number three. Okay. All right. Okay. I didn't know. I forgot.
So these three songs, the next two, put it this way, could trade off and on. I don't think I'd ever replace number one on this album. So number three this time around is going to be Shouted Out Loud. I do think this is 10 times the song Rock and Roll All Night is, and would have been a much better closing anthem for 40, 50 years. That's just my opinion. I love the guitar intro is, and that's something they can't replicate live. When they try, when they open this song, when they play this song live, it sounds so weeny. It's almost like a dee dee, but when you hear the album, it's a rare, rare. It's really and no matter what year it is, what decade it's from, every fucking live performance I've seen on TV or in person, that intro sounds so pussy. And I don't understand why. It's like it's not picking up the dueling guitars strong enough. It's like just one guy with one string going, bing, bing. It just, but if they could have perfected that, it would have been much better. Yeah.
You're right.
And I absolutely love. Go ahead.
Oh, no, you go ahead.
As I say, I absolutely love the Paul's ad libs in the end of the song. And even Gene with the, oh, yeah. This song moves from the minute it starts to the minute it ends. It's a perfect ad.
I was getting ready to start laughing because we was talking about this. Yeah, I can live with it in this. But when you get the Monster and Sonic Boom, oh, yeah. Oh. Okay, I'm done here. I ain't going no further.
So there you have it. Number three, Shout It Out Loud.
Yeah, hey, and you're right about switching it. I would love to have seen them switch this song with Rock and Roll All Night on the tours, man. If you think you got to play them, you can switch them two out and never miss a tour with them, bro. Let the audience wonder what you're going to end with.
Yep.
You know, all right, man. We're up to my number three now. And it is, you just touched on it, King of the Nighttime World, bro. coming out of Detroit Rock City, man, you know, to me, you can't play these two songs not back to back if you're going to play King of the Nighttime World in your set. I think that that's the 1-2 punch, man. The greatest probably opening, in my opinion, is that 1-2 punch, just to jack the audience, slam up. No stopping, none of that in between. And they didn't, I don't think. And they just went from one to the other. I love it when Kiss done that. One song to the next, man. One, bam, and just 3 or 4 songs in, then he standing out there, man, you know, and just oh, God, dude. Just rocked everybody out, man, without saying shit. And King of the Nighttime World, it was decades before I knew that wasn't their song. You see, I always thought this was their song. I never knew this was a remake, man. You know? I mean...
Whoa. What the fuck are you talking about?
Yeah, man.
That's a remake?
This is a song they took from somebody. And I've never heard the other version until... You told me about that Stones shit with the 2000 man. Hey, dude, this I've still never heard this one, man. Yeah, dude. And it was, hell, probably the mid-90s when they got back together, or a little later, around 2000, before I found out this one was, bro. I never knew. All of them they done, I thought, were their songs. Every redone song, even Then She Kissed Me, all of them. I never knew they were done beforehand, bro. This is a Kiss song, man. This is Kiss. This is Paul Stanley's song, pretty much, for his icon, you know, King of the Nighttime World, bro.
I'm looking at the song crediting or the writer credits. It's Paul Stanley and Kim Fowley.
Yeah. You'll have to, see who.
Oh, wait a minute. And also Mark Anthony. I wonder if that's the Van Halen Mark Anthony and Bob Ezrin. So maybe this was one of those songs that was originally written, but they pulled it from a writer because nobody recorded it. And then they kind of change things up and put their own touch on it. I'm going to have to do some research. I'd never heard that.
I'm pretty sure this is somebody else's song. I'm about 100% sure, dude. And like I said,
this Kim Fowley managed the Runaway.
And you don't think it was I can't remember. I've heard people talk about it, but I can't remember the band or the person who done this song, who wrote this song.
Interesting.
You can do some homework on that, and I will too, and we'll figure it out, man. But I do know that this is a cover. Yeah, and all those years I never knew, man. How would you? Kiss is the greatest at making whoever song they're doing their song. I will give them credit for that, bro. This song is badass from front to back. Peter's drumming, their Ace's lead, the whole thing. Paul just ripping it up, man. King of the Nighttime World is a absolute just rocking ass song, bro. Yep.
Okay, so I just found an article. It says, ever wonder why Kim Fowley was writing with Kiss in 1976? That's because King of the Nighttime World is a cover. In a weird situation, Kiss covered this song by little-known power pop band, The Hollywood Stars.
Yeah, okay.
The sole album was released during their heyday in the 77, self-titled effort, sunk without a trace, and was an overcooked disappointment with too much polish and not enough punch. Their version was eventually released in 2018, even though it was recorded in 1974. So I got the version right here in front of me. I'll have to listen to that after this is over. Wow. You learned me something today.
Yeah.
Okay.
Learned something new.
Okay. So that brings me to what? My number 2?
Yes, sir.
And number two is Flaming Youth. This was my biggest complaint my entire life, is that they never played this live, you know, within my lifetime, until that concert I went to in Minot. It's a Live 35 or whatever tour that was that I talked to you about. And that was the first time they broke it back out since they originally played. Yeah, whatever it was. I was just giddy, and I've got footage of it on my channel. I'll never forget it. Great song. I actually love what most Kiss podcasts, not the Calliope sound, and I didn't even know what the damn instrument's name was. But when they do that breakdown, you got the doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo. That's a Calliope, apparently. Absolutely love that sound. I love any song that breaks down and keeps singing and just brings it back up. The higher and higher and higher and higher.
Yeah, now that is wicked, man.
But what I don't like about them doing it live is he does that every fucking time. And that's supposed to be only the, or no, he just goes higher. And through the song, after every chorus, it's supposed to be higher and higher. And then eventually the end goes way.
Yes. You're right.
But I love the song, everything about it. I love, like you said, the imagery fits that album cover so well, with everything on fire and in rubble. Perfect. You know, and of course, you've got all of your, you know, immature kids back in the day. Oh, yo, Flaming Youth is flaming. They're homosexual. You just shut the fuck up. It's amazing what people come up with. Anyway, so yeah, that's number two for me. Epic song. Long overdue without being played, and once they started, they should have never stopped. I'll never forget Paul's bullshit excuse when I saw him in an interview. Well, it just doesn't go over well live. To who? Yeah. It doesn't translate live. I'm like, it's not like there's studio production in it that you can't replicate. What the hell?
Exactly.
Nah, whatever.
I don't get that either. That's another conversation too, bro. Yeah. There's just millions of things with this band. All right, it's the finale. My number two. Oh, yeah, my number two. And until here recently, this song was my number one for probably the last 10, 15 years. Damn, these top two, dude. Do You Love Me? My number two. A song that I've loved since day one. Peter's drums on this, on the studio version. The power. Just, and you know, just crack your ribs open, man. Paul's freaking vocals and the breakdown in the middle, like you said, man. Just, I was the happiest guy when I went and seen the reunion and the farewell, and they kept this in the set. I never got to see them play it, and it was my favorite song they done on both of them, Farewell and Reunion. This song here, they played it live spectacular. I loved it, and I love it to this day. Never get tired of it. Do You Love Me? Was my number one forever. I don't know how it slipped, but this is a tough one here at the top.
Yeah, that they actually played that on the farewell or the end of the road tour too that I went to.
Yeah, they didn't play it. They played Crazy Nights on the one I went to.
Yeah. So my numero uno is the very personification of Kiss for me. When I hear Kiss, the name Kiss, the first thing that comes to mind is Detroit Rock City, not Rock and Roll All Night, like all the Fairweather fans and casual listeners would like to think. Detroit Rock, it has nothing to do with their blowing up in Detroit long before anywhere. It has nothing to do with the backstory of Detroit at all.
Nope.
The song itself. Yeah, I mean, the song itself is just Kiss to me. That, if anybody were to say you get one song to try to explain to people who've never heard anything from Kiss what the band's about, that would be the song. It's got the greatest, most simple, recognizable, hummable sing-along solo ever written. And it wasn't even written by the band. It was written by Bob Ezrin.
Yes.
And when I say sing, I mean, you can have your Nuno Bettencourts, your Steve Vais, your Eddie Van Halens, and they're all out there putting this flashy goddamn solo in. And you're like, oh, wow, that's cool. 10 seconds later, you won't remember a note of it.
No.
How many songs can you sing the goddamn solo to from memory when the song's not even on, just like you could a chorus? This is the most beautifully done solo I've ever heard in my life. The song is fabulous from start to finish. And as a child, young kid, that intro was the most mysterious goddamn thing I'd ever heard. I wasn't sure if that was an actual newscast they put on here from a serious car accident or what the hell was going on. It was all of a sudden like, wait, is that Rock and Roll Night playing on the radio? I mean, the whole thing was just a trip to me. And the song just, that's the song that hooked me on Kiss. It was the first experience I had with them holding that, my brother's Destroyer album, and that goddamn, you know, intro's on with the guy in the car and shit. And I'm like, what the fuck am I listening to? And then, I mean, just, and it's over from there. I'm addicted. I'm a junkie. That's it. That's the end of it.
Yep. And here they come with,
dude. You said it better than I could. My number one's Detroit Rock City, bro. It, you just cannot. Yeah, I don't give a damn how many times you've heard it. It never gets old to me. It is Kiss. It when I think of Destroyer, that's what I think of. That's the image that I hold in my head, the intro, the song. It is Kiss Destroyer. Detroit Rock City. And if I'm not mistaken, the story is about a guy going to a Kiss concert in Charlotte, down the road here, man, and get killed in a car crash. But, you know, Charlotte Rock City, come on, man. Detroit was the one that grabbed them by the balls at first, too. You know, that city just embraced them. And look, man, that song, just like you said, as a kid sitting there listening to the intro, looking at the album covers, man, just wait, the build up. Just what the hell is happening here, man? Yeah. Rock and Roll All Night. Okay. First, I didn't even know what the lead was from. When the lead was in it, it's Rock and Roll All Night, but it took me forever to figure that out. And I was trying to figure it out. What's that song? What's that song off of? I would play song leads just trying to figure out what the fuck they're getting it from. And of course, it's the same song and off of Alive. And wow, just spectacular, bro. Bob Ezrin, tip my hat. To me, the best thing that he done with them. The first thing he done and the best thing he done with him was Destroyer.
Yeah.
I don't care what hard ass he was. He made it work. And damn, what a genius. That's all I can say. Yeah. Destroyer, love it. Always have. Always will. It is a absolute staple. Yeah. We might bitch and complain about the set list stuff, but the album is just spectacular, man.
It is the absolute closest they've ever had to a quote-unquote white album or a Slippery and Wet or a Hysteria or an Appetite for Destruction or, pick your band's, signature album. It would be Destroyer. It may not be my favorite. It may not be my favorite album now.
Yeah.
Because of overplay more than anything. But you cannot argue that this was the very defining moment of their career, and not because it jumped them into success. They found their sound. Going forward, this was the sound. And there's people who would prefer Hotter Than Hell, Dressed to Kill, and the original sound. Like it or not, this is the sound that made Kiss a household name.
Period. Yep. And that picture right there.
Yeah, one of the most iconic album covers by any band. By any band, that's one of the most iconic album covers.
Wow. Hey, I hope ain't nobody got anything bad to say about that one. They can't say nothing about our number one anyway. You know, so no. Hey, that was fun. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I like it when I can praise an entire Kiss album. That doesn't happen very often.
That's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Absolutely.
Okay, bro. We're good then. And until next time, thanks for watching.
Yes, sir.